Good morning to all of you. After a long time, I am taking a class for you. So today, I would like to start on the topic plasma proteins. So blood is an important component, like circulatory system. It is an important component of the body, which includes heart, blood vessels, and the blood as a main component. The total volume of the blood in the body is up to 4.5 to 5 liters. So that is why for blood donation, if you give hardly about 250 to 300 ml, doesn't make a big difference because we have got up to 4.5 to 5 liters of blood. Now in the blood, blood is like a heterogeneous substrate. It is like a heterogeneous solution. It contains not only the cells, but it is like a heterogeneous, like it has multiple components. It constitutes plasma and packed cell volumes. So we separate the water part and the substance part in the blood. So the plasma constitutes the liquid part of the blood, and the packed cells are the hematocrit, includes the cell part of the blood. So the plasma constitutes up to 55% to 60%, and the packed cell constitutes up to 40 to 45%. Now, what is the composition of a blood? 8% of a body weight is made up of blood, and of all the tissues, total body weight, 92% is made by other fluids and tissues. 8% of the body weight is made by blood. Now, the blood, when a blood sample is collected in a tube, now we have to understand the blood, when you look, it looks very homogeneous. When you put blood sample like that, it will be red in color and it looks completely, it is completely like a cell. You won't be seeing any particles floating or it or anything. But from where did we get the concept of the plasma proteins? Now, when blood is allowed to stand like this for a longer time, actually when you add anticoagulants and to prevent, and you know one of the best quality of the blood is that its clotting property. It won't stay as a liquid form for a longer period of time. It will get coagulated. So blood will be getting immediately coagulated. Now, if you take a blood sample in a test tube, and then you add an anticoagulant to prevent the coagulation of the blood, and you allow it to stand like that, or when you centrifuge it. See, when you are centrifuging, as I told you, the blood will be having cells and plasma. Cells are of higher weight, so they will settle to the bottom. When we centrifuge it, the cells will settle to the bottom and the liquid part will be present above. So that we call it as supernatant. The supernatant will be the plasma, and the sediment that is formed will be the cells in a centrifuge blood sample. Now the above thing we call it as plasma. Here what we have to remember is that in order to prevent the blood to clot, we have added anticoagulant. So here all the coagulation factors are intact. The blood has not at all clotted. So this plasma contains all the coagulation factors. Now, we'll see what is the composition of plasma. In plasma, 92% of the plasma has got water. Only 7% is protein, and only 1% of the plasma will have solutes. When we look into the sediment that is formed, above you have a small pore called as buffy coat. That buffy coat will be including platelets and leukocytes, and that will go in that order. So this buffy coat will slowly merge with the, it will be in continuation with the Packard cells. It will be in continuation with this formative cells. Now what do we have other than plasma? What else we have in the cells? We have platelets, we have leukocytes, and we have erythrocytes. Erythrocytes being heavy of all, they will settle exactly at the bottom of the tube. This is what happens when whole blood is centrifuged after adding an anticoagulant. It gets separated to plasma and it gets separated. It gets separated, the fractionated into plasma and into a sediment and a supernatant. The supernatant is plasma and the sediment are the cells. The plasma constitutes 7% of proteins, 92% of water and 1% of the solutes. The sediment that is formed by the cells present are platelets, leukocytes and erythrocytes. Now in the plasma, now what we are learning today is the plasma proteins. So in the plasma, what are the various proteins that are present? The proteins that are present, there are n number of proteins are present. We cannot remember n number of proteins like 1, 2, 3, 4 like that. So for us to remember it very easily, if we classify them into groups, it will be easy for us to remember. So what they have done, also all that n number of proteins that are present in the plasma, they are categorized into the four components. So albumin, globulins, fibrinogen and prothrombin. Most of the proteins will form in this group of the globulins. Small tiny proteins will fall in the group of globulins. Water, we know. Then what are the solutes that are usually present in the plasma? They are ions, that we call them as electrolytes, nutrients, glucose, amino acids, vitamins, all the nutrients. Waste products like creatinine, uric acid, urea, all those things, gases, then regulatory substances. So all these constitutes that 1% of the solute. Then platelets. The platelets are up to 1.4 to 3.4 lakhs are platelets. Then leukocytes, the WBC. The WBC are further categorized into neutrophils, lymphocytes, monocytes, eosinophils, and basophils. Don't worry about all these things. We'll be learning in detail about the WBC and everything in your physiology. This is just to mention what are the cells that are present in the blood. I'm just giving you the names. Platelets, leukocytes, and erythrocytes that are RBC. So this is what constitutes the plasma. Now, one more word that we regularly use is serum. Now, what is the difference between plasma and serum? Plasma. The plasma is anticoagulants are needed for, these will be utilizing anticoagulants. When you add anticoagulant into a blood sample and you mix it very properly, what will happen? The blood will not clot. And when the blood doesn't clot, the fibrinogen is present intact. All the coagulation factors, along with that, the fibrinogen is present intact. So, the fibrinogen is not being utilized. So, anticoagulant is added to get plasma. It can be prepared as soon as it is mixed thoroughly. Once you add the anticoagulant, you mix the anticoagulant and you can centrifuge it immediately. The platelets and the cells can contaminate the liquid fraction because there is no separate barrier between the cells. Now, when it gets precipitated, it will precipitate in this way. First, you will have plasma. Then you have a buffy coat. That buffy coat will be containing the WBC and platelets. And then you will be having the RBC. Even after centrifugation, you can clearly see a tube like this. But if you mix the tube, once again, this everything will become homogeneous. Everything will become uniform. This demarcation won't be there. This demarcation won't appear. So that is the thing. So this has to be, if you have want to have the plasma, it has to be centrifuged and you have to remove the plasma immediately. Or you have to place the tube unshaken in a place where it is not touched or it is shaken. Otherwise, what will happen? Everything will get mixed up once again. Composition of the ions is representative of the circulating blood. Considered less stable, and especially during long storage. You cannot store it for a very longer time. Now, whatever we see, the composition of the components in the plasma are exactly same as that you see in the whole blood, in the circulating whole blood, because this is the way the blood exists in our body. We have anticoagulants like heparin that will be preventing intravascular coagulation. So this gives a clear picture of the whole blood that is circulating in our body. Now, what is serum? The serum, in serum, what you do is you take the blood sample and you won't be adding any anticoagulant, and you leave it like that for some time. What will happen after 20 minutes? The blood will start clotting, and after 20 to 30 minutes, a clot will be formed completely. What will be formed in the clot? All the coagulation factors are being utilized, and all the cells will come together and they will be forming a clot, a thick stone-like structure. Now, here, that is the reason why, in case of now, if you pick up the serum and after that you basically centrifuge it. When you centrifuge it, because of the weight, the clot will come down, and above you have a very clear and transparent layer. This clear and transparent layer will be having, what do we have in that? Will be having the serum, and that is completely devoid of all the coagulation factors. The main difference between this serum and this plasma is that this plasma has got the coagulation factors and fibrinogen. The serum doesn't have the coagulation factors and fibrinogen. Cleaner sample, depleted of all the cells and cell remnants, because all the cells and cell remnants are present in the clot. But latent clotting can lead to fibrin formation if you leave like that. Clot retraction elevates the potassium level relative to that of the plasma level. Because the clot is formed and the clot is getting retracted, what will happen? The potassium that is present inside the cell can come out into the serum. As a result of that, in the serum, there are chances of having slightly increased potassium when compared to the whole blood. It is considered very stable, because even if you mix also, it has formed a clot, and the clot is like a solid substance. Even if you mix the tube also, the solid substance will not get combined with the serum. It won't become homogeneous. As it becomes homogeneous in this tube, this will not become homogeneous. So if you want to store sample for a longer duration of time, plasma is an ideal one. You can take the plasma, serum is an ideal one. You can take the serum, you can put it in small aliquots, and you can freeze it to minus 80 degrees. It can be stored for a very, very longer time. So that is the difference between plasma and serum. So the main difference is that in plasma, the anticoagulation is being added. As a result of that, plasma will have all the clotting factors, and the ionic composition is exactly similar to that of the whole blood. Whereas in serum, anticoagulant is not added. As a result of that, serum is completely depleted of the fibrinogen and the coagulation factors. And one more thing is that there are chances of having higher levels of potassium when compared to that of the whole blood, because from the clot, from the cells that are present in the clot, the potassium might have come out. That could be the reason. And when we think of stability, serum is more stable. If you want to put it for biobanking, it is more stable when compared to that of the plasma. Next, so this thing about the serum and the plasma. Now we'll concentrate now on the plasma proteins. Plasma proteins. These plasma proteins comprise the major part of solids of the plasma. They are complex mixtures which includes not only simple proteins but also conjugated proteins such as glycoproteins and lipoproteins. You know what is a simple protein? The simple protein is a protein that does not have any other groups. It is a pure polypeptide chain, and it will not have any other groups associated with that. Conjugated proteins are the proteins that are in conjugation with some non-carbohydrate. sorry, the conjugated proteins are the one that are in conjugation with some non-protein substances, as in glycoprotein. In glycoprotein, the glucose is present or carbohydrate is associated with the protein. Lipoprotein, the protein is associated with lipids. So, the plasma proteins are not the simple proteins. They also include conjugated proteins. The commonly, though we have n number of plasma proteins, very few common things are there, that are very few features are there that are common among all the plasma proteins. Mostly, and as I stated you that we have almost up to n number of proteins, as many proteins are there, but function of few of the proteins is very significant when compared to the function of some other proteins. So that is why, and we cannot read one in a sequence of 1 to 100. The better way is if we categorize them, it will be easy for us to understand. So for that reason, they are categorized based upon their electrophoretic mobility. If you remember, in chemistry of proteins, we have told you the principle of electrophoresis. So on the basis of their electrophoretic mobility, they are put into that particular groups. Like broadly, if you say they are, we have albumin, we have fibrinogen, we have albumin, globulins and fibrinogen. This is a very broad criteria, and the most of the proteins will form, albumin itself is a separate protein, and all the small tiny proteins will fall under the group of the globulins. And fibrinogen anyhow, because why are we calling fibrinogen separately? Because fibrinogen, that is the factor that differentiates the serum from the plasma. That is the one that differentiates serum from the plasma. So we have put fibrinogen as separate category. Now there are few features that are common for the plasma proteins. Almost all the plasma proteins are synthesized in the liver except for immunoglobulins. These immunoglobulins are produced by the plasma cells. Other than that, all of them are synthesized in the liver. Almost all the plasma proteins are glycoproteins. Even albumin, that is simplest of all the plasma proteins, some of them may say it as a simple protein, but few carbohydrate moieties are attached to it. Many plasma proteins exhibit polymorphism. They exist in more than one form, like alpha-1 antitrypsin, transferrin and haptoglobin. So these are the ones that will be existing as polymorphs. Each plasma protein has a characteristic half-life in the circulation. And plasma proteins, some of the plasma proteins will act as acute phase reactants. They are acute phase, they respond to the acute inflammation or acute changes that occur in the body. So, plasma proteins act as acute phase reactants. So, the common thing is that they are synthesized in the liver except for the immunoglobulins. All of them are glycoproteins. They exhibit polymorphism. Each one has got a characteristic half-life, and most of them are acute phase reactants. That is, they either increase in response to an acute condition or they decrease in response to an acute condition. So that is why we call them as acute phase proteins. Now, classification of plasma proteins. As I told you, based on the electrophoretic mobility, they are classified into 5 groups. Albumin, alpha-1, alpha-2 globulins, beta-globulins and gamma-globulins. We won't bifurcate beta-globulins because few of them will form under beta-globulins. So, you have alpha-1 albumin, 2 alpha-1, 3 alpha-2, 4 beta-globulins and 5th one is the gamma-globulin. Now, just to recap you, what is electrophoresis? Electrophoresis is a method in which the particles are separated based on their charge, based on their charge and the mass and their activity on the electric field. So, the substances are allowed to pass through an electrical field. Based on their mass and charge, their mobility depends. Now, this is how electrophoresis is done. This is a sample application and this is a cathodal end. When the sample is applied here and the current is allowed to pass. And when the current passes, From the sample, the substances will start moving, the solutes will start moving, and based upon the charge and their molecular weight, they stop at this particular point. So when we have applied the plasma here and subjected to the electrical field, the plasma proteins have run in this form. Now, based on which zone they have fallen on, based on which zone they are there, they are labeled according to that category. Now, the one that moves farthest from the cathode end is the anode, because the one that moves very fast from the cathode end to the anode is albumin. So this is albumin that constitutes major part, up to 60% of the plasma proteins. Then comes the alpha 1 band, then comes alpha 2 band, beta 1 band, beta 2 and gamma band. So these are nothing but the bands. We call it as albumin. So albumin, most albumin falls only in this region, and it is only the albumin that is present in that region. So they have named the name of the band. They have named the band itself as albumin. Now this band is alpha 1, in which we have up to 5 to 6 types of the proteins falling in that. We have alpha 2 band, in which some 5 to 6 proteins are there. We have beta 1 band, in which somewhere around 7 to 8 proteins are there. We have beta 2 band, in which we have up to 2 to 3 proteins. And then gamma band. In the gamma regions are heaviest of all the proteins, that is mainly occupied by the immunoglobulins, because they are heavily and they are positively charged. They just don't move from the point of application, they just stay at the point of application. A little bit they will be moving. So whole of the gamma region is occupied by the immunoglobulins. Plasma proteins. So as I told you, broadly the plasma proteins can be classified into albumins, globulins and fibrinogens. As I stated, why did we put fibrinogen separately? Because this is the one that separates the serum from the plasma. Now, in globulins, you have alpha 1, alpha 2, beta and gamma. So this is whole is a composition of all the globulins and the albumin. Now, as I told you, we have in alpha 1, we have some number of proteins. In alpha 2 region, we have some number of proteins. And in that way, we have some number of proteins. Now, in this table, I'm going to show you what proteins fall in which group. As I told you, albumin is the one that moves very fast. And this is the one that is very farther, that is very, very far from the, this is the one that is very, very far from the point of application. Now, before albumin, you have prealbumin. Before albumin, in front of albumin, you will be having prealbumin that constitutes mainly the protein that transports thyroid hormone, that transport thyroxin to some extent. So you call it as prealbumin. So in the albumin zone, you have albumin and prealbumin. The functions of albumin detailing we will be covering in the next in the sequence. Now, next one is after albumin, if you remember, it is alpha 1. After albumin, it is alpha 1. You remember the order in which it goes. This is the order that is farther away from the point of application. At the point of application, you have gamma. If we are going from the point of application, it will start with gamma, beta 2, beta 1, alpha 2, alpha 1 and then albumin. For easy conversion, we mix up both beta 1 and beta 2 because very small number of proteins are there. So beta 1 and beta 2 are merged and collectively we call it as beta. So from point of application, it will go like gamma, beta, alpha and then albumin. So now we have seen what are present in albumin. Albumin will purely have only albumin, this zone will have only albumin, and here you have a prealbumin that is present a little bit here. Now we'll see what proteins fall in this alpha 1 region. So in this band, what all proteins fall in that band? The proteins that fall on that band are up to 0.3 to 0.5 grams per deciliter. Now what are they? Alpha 1 antitrypsin that constitutes up to less than 0.2%, and it is an inhibitor of trypsin enzyme. Trypsin is a proteolytic enzyme. It prevents the activity of this trypsin. Remember, this is present in the plasma. Trypsin, this is the alpha 1 antitrypsin that we are talking is present in the plasma. Now alpha 1 lipoprotein that will be carrying the lipo, that will be carrying the lipids, and it is a HDL, high density lipoprotein that transport cholesterol from the peripheral tissues into the liver. Then uracil mucoid, this is a protein that binds with the progesterone. Next is retinol binding protein. This retinol binding protein is the one that will be transporting the retinol, that is nothing but vitamin A. Then thyroxin binding globulin, the one that binds and transports the thyroxin. Then transcarotin or cortisol binding protein, the one that transports the cortisol. So most of the carrier proteins will form in the alpha 1 region. Then alpha 2 region. Alpha 2 region will be including alpha 2 macroglobulin that has got both antitrypsin and antiplasmin activity. That is, these will be preventing the plasmin. These will be preventing the coagulation. Then haptoglobins. The haptoglobins are the ones that will bind to free hemoglobin and prevents its excretion. Because the free hemoglobin, when hemoglobin is broken, when RBC is broken down, hemoglobin comes out of it. And this hemoglobin is also broken down into heme and globin. Globin is a protein part, so it will go into the protein synthesis once again. Whereas the heme part, which contains porphyrin rings, which contains iron at the center, that has to be disposed very carefully. Because once this iron comes out into the circulating system, it is a powerful free radical. It is a powerful free radical, so it can destroy all the blood vessels. So very carefully, that heme part of the hemoglobin has to be removed. And that is done when the heme separates from the hemoglobin. It is immediately caught by the haptoglobins. Next, prothrombin. We know the prothrombin is the one that is required for blood clotting. Next is ceruloplasmin. Ceruloplasmin is a protein that will be transporting the copper, that will transport the copper from the diet into the liver. And the ceruloplasmin is also important because this will be helping in absorption of iron. So these are the ones that fall in alpha 2. There are many proteins that fall in alpha 2, but we are concentrating the ones that are very, very important. Next is beta. The beta will include beta lipoproteins. So in the lipoproteins, if you remember, only HDL falls in alpha 1 region. Other than that, all the other lipoproteins will fall in beta globulin region. So the beta lipoproteins, beta globulin region, especially the HDL, that will be transporting triacylglycerol and cholesterol from the liver and from the tissues into the peripheral tissues, from the liver and into the circulation to the peripheral tissues. Next is transferrin, the one that transfers the iron. Hemopexin, the one that transports the heme. Plasminogen, the one that transport the plasminogen, the one that forms the plasmin and which is involved in fibrinolysis. So the beta globulins will be including beta lipoproteins, transferrin, hemopexin and plasminogen. Gamma globulins. The gamma globulins will be including all the immunoglobulins that will bring about the immunogenic property. Next, I told you, you have fibrinogen that is present separately. This fibrinogen will participate in blood coagulation. So, again, to have a little bit of concept, I have put in this way. So, albumin, this is a point of application. When the sample is run, it will run and we will be seeing these bands in the electrophoresis. So, in the albumin band, albumin is present. In the alpha 1 region, we see alpha 1 antitrypsin, thyroid binding globulin, transferrin, and HDL. In case of alpha 2 region, we see haptoglobulin, ceruloplasmin and alpha 2 microglobulin. In beta region, we see transferrin and beta lipoproteins. And in the gamma region, we see the antibodies. So this is how the distribution is there. So once again, I would like to tell you that this categorization of alpha 1, alpha 2, beta and gamma is based upon their electrophoretic mobility. Based on electrophoretic mobility, these are grouped into those categories. Now, what are the reference ranges? The total plasma protein in the body is up to 6 to 8 grams per deciliter. Remember, the plasma proteins in the circulation are present in grams, not as milligrams. Whereas blood glucose, urea, creatinine, all these things are present in milligrams. Plasma proteins are present in grams. Now, of which albumin constitutes up to 3.5 to 5 grams, globulin constitutes up to 2.5 to 3.5 grams. And always we have to mention that it is per deciliter. Per 100 ml of the blood, you have 6 to 8 grams. Next is fibrinogen, that constitutes up to 200 to 400 milligrams. Remember, this is milligrams. That is 0.2 to 0.4 grams per deciliter. So this is the these are the reference ranges for total plasma proteins. Now, AG ratio is one. Now, by just looking at that AG ratio, we know that albumin constitutes a major part. So the AG ratio will be usually greater than 1. It is 1.2 to 1.5. There are few features where the albumin levels are decreased and globulin levels are increased, and then the AG ratio get reversed. Now, it is greater than 1. Slowly, when the globulin levels increases, as the denominator increases and the numerator decreases, obviously, the ratio will be becoming less than 1. So, the reversal of AG ratio happens in some of the diseases that we will learn. Next, albumin. So, as I told you, detailing of this albumin is very important. It can come as short note for you. Last time we have got questions from albumin. So, albumin constitutes the major part of the plasma protein. And for exam point of view also, this is very important. Now, albumin. It constitutes up to 60% of the total plasma proteins. The only single protein that constitutes up to 60% of the total plasma proteins. That is the greatness of albumin. 40% of the albumin is present in the plasma and 60% is present in the extracellular space. And the half-life of albumin is about 20 days. And it migrates fastest in the electrophoresis in alkaline pH. That is why when we look into the slide of the electrophoretic slide, it moves very fastest and it is present almost at the anode level. It is very far off from the point of application. Because of its less molecular weight and the charge, more of negative charge, it will be moving very fast to the anodal end. Liver will be producing the albumin. Liver is the only organ that is capable of producing the albumin, and that is up to 12 grams per day. 12 grams of albumin is produced per day because so much of albumin is produced by the liver, and being the liver only organ to produce albumin, the estimation of amount of albumin in the blood is used as one of the important parameters in assessing the function of the liver. It is a globular protein containing up to 585 amino acids and 17 disulfide bonds. Its molecular weight is up to 69 kilodaltons. What are the functions? Now, the functions of the albumin, when they ask you what is the function of the albumin, the first thing that has to come to your mind is maintaining colloidal osmotic pressure. That is the primary and very, very important function of the albumin. In your exam, if you are asked about what are the functions of albumin, or if you get a question on functions of the albumin, your first point should be maintaining the colloidal osmotic pressure. Number one, it should be there. There should not be any change in the order. Number one is always maintenance of colloidal osmotic pressure. Albumin maintains colloidal osmotic pressure, responsible for up to 75 to 80%. And because of its low molecular weight and higher concentration, it is able to do that. It plays a pivotal role in maintaining the blood volume and blood fluid distribution. Now, we know that extracellular space is there. You have extracellular space is there. You have the three major components in the human body are the fluid parts. The fluid is present in the blood vessels. The fluid is present inside the cell, intracellular. The fluid is present in the extracellular region. So extracellular till the time being will consider it as interstitial part. So the interstitial part, the one that is present between the cell and the blood vessel. So in these three zones, water is there. Sometimes what will happen if the water levels are obviously low inside the cell and in the extracellular matrix, and the watery content is very high in case of the blood. But each time from the bed, water is not going out into the extracellular space. It is mainly because of the presence of albumin. Now, the things that hold water inside the capillaries, two pressures are very much required that will be holding the fluid in the blood vessels and holding the fluid in the interstitial space. The two things mainly are the hydrostatic pressure and the osmotic pressure. The hydrostatic pressure is the pressure that is exerted by the water. The osmotic pressure is the pressure that is exerted by the proteins. So, the proteins present in the plasma inside the cell, they decrease the osmotic pressure and prevent the entry of water or sodium from the artery or from the blood vessel into the interstitial space. So the two pressures that maintain the fluidity in the interstitial space and also blood vessel, fluid homeostasis, is by two types of pressures called as osmotic pressure and the hydrostatic pressure. The hydrostatic pressure is the pressure that is exerted by the fluids and fluids of the plasma and also the interstitial fluid. The osmotic pressure is the one that is applied by the solutes, other solids like the cells that are present in the blood vessels and also in the interstitial space. Now, what do the albumin do? This albumin, being a bit not higher in size, albumin does not move out of the normal capillaries. Now, when this albumin does not move of the normal capillaries, albumin does not move through the normal capillary pores. Why? Water and small biological components can move. Now, sodium is highly attracted to the albumin, and together they help in maintaining the colloidal osmotic pressure by attracting the water into the intravascular space. Inside the vascular space. So albumin is bound to sodium and it has got a very good property of retaining the water. As a result of that, water that is present in the interstitial space will enter into the blood vessel. So this how it helps in maintaining the colloidal osmotic pressure. It holds up the sodium and prevents the and allows the entry of water from the interstitial spaces into the blood vessel. So even though the blood vessel has got higher amount of the water, even then the interstitial cells and all the cells will dump water into the blood vessels. Now, first function you have to tell is for maintaining the colloidal osmotic pressure. The number two function is the transportation function. It is a very, very good vehicle, or you can call it as a taxi, that transports various substances from one point to the another point. It has an ability to bind to various ligands and thus acts as a transporter for various molecules. These will be including free fatty acids. The transporter for free fatty acids is only albumin, calcium, some of the steroid hormones, not all the steroid hormones, bilirubin, copper. Bilirubin and free fatty acids, the albumin is the only mode of the transport, whereas for copper you have ceruloplasmin, but to some extent the copper is also transported by the albumin. Then comes the drugs. All the drugs that we take, all any type of the drug that we take, it is transported from the GIT to that particular part or to the liver by the albumin. Mostly the sulfonamides, antibiotics, anticoagulants, the aspirin, phenytoin. So sulfonamide is an anticoagulant, sulfonamide is an antibiotic, penicillins are antibiotics, dicumarol is an anticoagulant, phenytoin is usually given in convulsions or epileptic patients, and then aspirin. That will be preventing it clotting. It is also anticoagulant. So all these things are transported mainly by the albumin. So the first is osmotic pressure, second is transport function. Then nutritive function. It serves amino acids for the tissues, for protein synthesis. It's very limited. When the person is in very bad and very in starved phase, this albumin is broken down and it can provide some of the essential amino acids. Next, this is also a very, very important function. It has got maximum buffering capacity. In the plasma, we need to have some buffer. So in the plasma, this albumin has got maximum buffering capacity because of its higher concentration and presence of histidine residues. The importance of histidine is that histidine will be acting, histidine has been the isolate, the pH of the isolated pH of the histidine is near the blood pH. That is why any substances that are rich with histidine can act as natural anticoagulants to our body. It can act as anticoagulant. It can be acting as a powerful buffering agent. Next, viscosity. It helps in maintaining less viscous so that the blood doesn't become very thick. It is fluid and disturbant inflow of the maintains lesser viscosity. It lowers the viscosity because of the substances and all that. There are chances that this can become more viscous, so the viscosity is decreased by the albumin. Next, so till now the main functions are: number one is maintaining colloidal osmotic pressure, number two is transport function, number three is nutritive function, number four is buffering function, and number five is decreasing the viscosity. So these are the five major functions of the albumin. Another important is that why in transport function it is very important, because these, when they are bound to the albumin, they cannot cross the blood-brain barrier and can enter into the brain. That is the advantage of the drugs being attached. That is the advantage of having drugs being attached to the albumin, because it doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier and it does not get filtered into the glomerulus also. So these substances do not get immediately appeared. They won't get immediately appeared in the urine. Blood-brain barrier. Albumin and free fatty acids form complexes which cannot cross the blood-brain barrier, and hence fatty acids are not utilized by the brain. Binding with bilirubin. The binding of the albumin with bilirubin is very, very less. Actually, what will happen that in case of hemolysis will take place in the spleen and all that, and the bilirubin that is present, it has to get conjugated. The bilirubin is insoluble. That has to be made soluble. That can be done only in the liver. So from all the tissues where bilirubin is formed, the substances pick up the albumin, basically picks up the bilirubin and gets it into the liver. But the bonding between the albumin and the bilirubin is very loose. So what will happen, any some other thing comes, the bond will break and the albumin will go with that other substance and bilirubin is left behind like that. So this is loosely bound bilirubin to albumin, can easily get replaced by drugs such as aspirin. In newborns, if these drugs are given, actually in the newborns, the liver itself is being immature, the liver itself is immature, and after coming out, hemolysis will take place. As a result of that, the child is more prone to become have jaundice, more prone to have hemolysis. So in that type of situation, if we give some of the tablets that will interact, that will have drug interactions with the albumin, then the condition can go much more severe. And along with that, that albumin, the free bilirubin that is not associated with the albumin, it can enter, it can cross the blood-brain barriers and it can enter into the brain. And that can lead to a very dangerous disorder called as carnicteris. When bilirubin gets deposited in the brain, you get a condition called as carnicteris, and that is very, very dangerous and very, very fatal. Next, protein bound calcium. As I told you, some of the ions, calcium is also bound by the protein. But the importance is that the calcium, whenever the albumin levels decrease in the body, proportionally calcium levels will also decrease. But this you have to consider it as a pseudo decrease in the calcium, because the total calcium what is required for our body is not the serum total calcium. What is required by the body is the ionic calcium. So this ionic calcium is not changed. So serum total calcium may be decreased, but ionic calcium does not change, because this ionic calcium is not changing, because ionic calcium is not. The calcium is lowered up to 0.8 milligrams per deciliter for every fall of 1 gram per deciliter of the albumin. Next, drug interactions. This plays a very important role. As I told you, the albumin is the one that will be helping in transporting of various drugs. Now, if there are two drugs that are there are two drugs that are competing for that transport site of an albumin, like we see competitive inhibition. The competitive inhibition, that is a competition for the active site. In the same way, there is competition for that site of the albumin between the two drugs. So what will happen? One drug may succeed, other may get failed. So that care has to be taken when we are giving combination drugs like phenytoin and dicumarol. Phenytoin is used in anticonvulsants to decrease the epilepsy, and dicumarol is the one that is used as an anticoagulant. This is an antagonistic of vitamin K. When both of them are given in conjugation with another, already the person who has phenytoin is already epileptic prone. He is already epileptic prone and he stays in a room somewhere here. So what will happen if a person who is epileptic, when they give vitamin K, when they give dicumarol along with that, the dicumarol will bind and the phenytoin binding will decrease. As a result of that, the phenytoin levels will be decreasing and the person is prone to have the convulsions. So drug interactions have to be clinically taken care in phenytoin and dicumarol when drug interactions will occur. So when we are giving combination of drugs, a little bit of caution has to be taken. Therapeutical use. The albumin is also used in giving IV in case of patients who are suffering with burns, hemorrhages, and in shock treatment. IV albumin is given for therapeutical purpose. Now, hypoalbuminemia. The disorders that are associated with the albumin, hypo means decreased, hyper means high. Usually we see many conditions where there is decreased albumin levels when compared to increased albumin levels. Hypo is a condition. Now, as I told you, the first and primary function of albumin is to maintain the colloidal osmotic pressure. Now, in case of hypoalbuminemia, where albumin levels are decreased, this is not at all maintained. The osmotic pressure is not at all maintained. As a result of that, from the plasma, the water that is present in the plasma will move into the interstitial spaces. The water has to be in the plasma, it should not go into the interstitial spaces. In this condition, what will happen? The water will move into the interstitial spaces. As a result, what will happen? Edema will result. So edema means the hypoalbuminemia results in fluid retention in the tissue spaces. In that way, normally what will happen, the albumin will bind with the water and it will prevent the outflow of the water. Now, when albumin is not there, what will happen? The water will freely move into the interstitial spaces. As a result of that, the fluid will get accumulated, and this is characteristically identified by pitting edema. You call it, specifically call the word called as pitting edema. When you just press the part, when you press just press the swollen part, you can see that a pit has formed. A pit has formed, that is what you can see. So a pit will be forming and it does not come back to the normal. It does not come back. So this is called as pitting edema. The pitting edema is a characteristic feature of hypoalbuminemia. It is a characteristic feature of hypoalbuminemia, indicating that the interstitial spaces have got fluid accumulated. Now, once again, I would like to tell about all the conditions that will lead to the hypoalbuminemia. Physiologically, pregnancy is a commonest cause. That is why in late pregnancy, we can see that sometimes the foot and everything will become edematous. That is a common, that is physiological, because once the delivery occurs, all these things will go up. So that is why we call it as physiological. Means without any organic diseases, that will go up by itself, you call it as physiological. Then physical exercise also, there are chances of having decreased levels of albumin, but both will come under physiological. Now, pathological is characterized into different phase. One is where there is impaired synthesis, where there is increased catabolism, where there is abnormal distribution, where there is abnormal or excessive loss, or overhydration due to hemodilution. So these are the various causes, pathological causes. One, you can say number one is when there is a defect in the synthesis, number one. Number two, the synthesis is normal, but the catabolism is very, very high. Then also there are chances of decreased albumin levels. Number three, the distribution is abnormal. It has to be somewhere, but it is going and getting distributed somewhere else. Number four, excessive loss. Not only catabolism, but there is loss. It is getting lost. Albumin is getting lost like that. Catabolism means it is being broken down. It is catabolized, it is broken down. Loss means it is lost like albumin only. Then overhydration, too much of water is added so that it has become completely diluted. So in those conditions, we see hypoalbuminemia. Yeah. Now what are the conditions where there is impaired synthesis or more utilization? Impaired synthesis or more utilization, as we see in malnutrition, malabsorption syndrome, where the absorption is not taking place properly. Then in chronic liver disorder, as I told you, liver is a only organ which will be synthesizing the albumin. So in case of liver disorders, there are chances of decreased synthesis of albumin. As a result of that, hypoalbuminemia will occur. And albuminemia is a condition where there is complete absence of synthesis of albumin. Next, increased catabolism. The increased catabolism you see in injuries like major surgery or trauma, in case of infections, in fever, and in malignant diseases. Abnormal distribution, as in severe burns, edema, and ascites. Ascites means if the fluid gets accumulated in the abdomen, you call it as ascites. Abnormal or excessive loss. If it is lost, the albumin is lost like that only, as in nephrotic syndrome, as in gastrointestinal diseases. Specifically, you use the word protein losing enteropathy. So that is classically used for gastrointestinal diseases. Then burns and other skin conditions, hemorrhages, inflammations. In all these conditions, there is excessive loss. So these are the pathological conditions: impaired synthesis, increased breakdown, abnormal distribution, loss, and hemodilution. These are the five pathological features that will be decreasing the albumin levels in the body. Now, I have given all the five, but we'll concentrate only on five or six features that are very important and that are very common for hypoalbuminemia. Cirrhosis. Cirrhosis of the liver. In cirrhosis of the liver, why do we see hypoalbuminemia? Because there is decreased synthesis. The liver has become fibrous and it is not able to synthesize the albumin. Next, malnutrition. In malnutrition, what will happen? Whatever amino acids that are available, the body has to utilize it. So what will it do? It will break down the albumin, because it is only plasma protein that is present in very larger amounts in the body. So it will break down the albumin. Next, in nephrotic syndrome. Nephrotic syndrome is a very important to remember. Nephrotic syndrome is a disorder where permeability of kidneys is affected. Normally, protein is completely impermeable. Proteins does not appear in urine. That is a characteristic feature. Because of their high molecular mass and all that, they do not get filtered in the glomerulus. They stay above the filter in the glomerulus. In the glomerular filtrate also, very some of the small proteins appear. But once again, they are reabsorbed during the course of the circulation. So, when the holes for that sieve becomes bigger, the holes of the sieve becomes bigger, what will happen? Albumin will also enter into the glomerular filtrate. So the permeability of the kidney glomerular membrane is defective. As a result of that, albumin is excreted in larger quantities. Then protein losing enteropathies. Larger quantities of albumin is lost from the intestinal tract. So this is a normal liver and this is a liver with cirrhosis. You can see how big difference it is. That is the reason this type of liver cannot synthesize albumin. Next, this is a normal glomerulus where you can have normal podocytes and all that. But now what will happen? You can see there is problem with the podocytes. So what will happen? The filtration is affected. So what all that is, protein that is present in the blood will appear into the urine, it will appear into the glomerular filtrate. So normal glomerulus is very neatly defined like that, whereas with the nephrotic syndrome, the sieves, the size of the sieves has increased. As a result of that, protein will enter into the urine. Next, malnutrition. The child who is not eating any, the malnutrition child, where food is not available, in malnutrition also we will be seeing the decreased albumin levels. hyperalbuminemia. In conditions of fluid depletion, when there is hemoconcentration, it is sort of a relative term. When the when there is hemoconcentration, what will happen? It will look as if the albumin levels are very, very high. That is called hyperalbuminemia. Next is albumin urea. Albumin, anything, if anything ends with urea, it means that we are talking about this metabolite in the urine, albumin urea. The presence of albumin in urine is called albumin urea. Proteinuria means presence of protein. The protein could be anything other than albumin also. So urea is a very broader term. Albumin urea is a very specific term. We are talking only about the albumin. If other proteins are present, we would have called it as proteinuria. And albuminuria is never physiological, it is always pathological. It is seen in nephrotic syndrome, as I told you, where larger quantities of the protein will leak into the glomerular filtrate, because the glomerular filtrate, the sieve of the glomerulus, has become larger in size. As a result of that, the filtration is not taking place properly and all the protein is entering into the glomerular filtrate. Next, in case of acute nephritis, where there is inflammation to the nephrons, there also the permeability increases and the protein will be entering into the glomerular filtrate. Then inflammatory conditions of urinary tract. So in all the conditions, what is happening is permeability of the blood vessels is increasing. When the permeability increases, the albumin will come out of the blood vessels and it will enter into the glomerular filtrate. Next, the presence of the albumin can be detected by heat and acetic acid test, that is a heat coagulation test or heat and acetic acid test. How do you do the heat and acetic acid test? We have to take urine or the given urine sample in a test tube up to 3-4, and then you have to heat the upper layers of the test tube. After heating the upper layers of the test tube, you add 1 to 2 drops of acetic acid. Now, after adding to the upper layer of test tubes and after adding acetic acid also, if you see now, once you heat the upper layers, obviously you can see a coagulum or clot. After adding acetic acid also, if the coagulum or clot is appearing, it means that the clot is formed because of the albumin, because on heating the albumin has got denatured and it has become white, like egg white. And you have egg white when it is egg is not boiled, normal egg, it will be transparent, but once you boil it, what will happen? It will become white. So in that way, similar to that, this will also become very white. Even after adding acetic acid also, if the clot doesn't dissolve, it means that the clot is made up of protein only. Now you add acetic acid and once again you heat, and after you heat it for some time, you can see very thick precipitate or cloudy precipitate is usually seen. So this will be telling you that the thing that is present is the albumin. Next is microalbuminuria. You know albuminuria, where albumin is present. Micro means very tiny amount of albumin is present in the urine, that we call it as microalbuminuria. In microalbuminuria or minimal albuminuria, or you also call it as plossy albuminuria, very smaller quantity of albumin is present, that is 30 to 300. Below 30, it is not at all detected. Above 300 is considered to be as albuminuria. Now, the border between 30 to 300, you call it as microalbuminuria. And this cannot be detected. This 30 to 300 cannot be detected by the normal heat and acetic acid test. You will be requiring special immunological assays to identify those, to quantify that albumin. Increased levels. Why are we so much concerned about microalbuminuria is that the increased levels of microalbumin, it is a best indicator for the involvement of renal disease in diabetic patients. In diabetic patients, if they are having early complications, if they are prone to develop the renal disease, the first and very early sign that they develop is the microalbuminuria. So that how the microalbuminuria is significant. Now, if you just look into the how much would be the albuminuria? Normal albuminuria will be less than 30. If it takes spot collection or 24-hour collection, it will be less than 30. Microalbuminuria will be somewhere between 30 to 299. Macroalbuminuria will be greater than or equal to 300. This is the 24-hour collection, how the things will vary. So below 30 is normal. between 30 to 300 is macroalbuminuria. Above 300 you call it as, above 300 you call it as macroalbuminuria. Now, N-albuminuria. N-albuminuria and AN, anything and represents complete absence. So, N-albuminuria is complete absence of the albumin, but generally you don't have zero albumin in the body. We use the term N-albuminuria when the plasma albumin levels are less than 1 g/cl. It is not always that there will be zero synthesis of albumin in the body, because liver is there, at least some amount of the albumin is always synthesized. So when the synthesis is almost less than 1 g/dL, we call it as N-albuminuria. So till now we have covered the albumin. You have to remember albumin is very important for your exam point of view, and as I already told you the functions of albumin. When I say albumin, the first thing that has to come to your mind is maintenance of colloidal osmotic pressure, second is transport, third is buffer, then acting as a nutrient and all that. So it should go in that order. First is oncotic pressure. That is the reason why when albumin levels are decreased in the body, the patient will present with edema. The patient will first present with edema, then he will present with all the other disorders later, but he will come with edema only. So that is important, because that function is so much important. So that is what we covered about albumin. Here the diseases you have to remember is, you have to remember what happens in cirrhosis, what happens in nephrotic syndrome. And after the globulins are over, we will collectively see what will happen to all the plasma proteins in particular set of diseases. So in afternoon class, I am going to cover the globulins and the diseases that are associated with the plasma proteins. We will continue our class between 2 to 3.